if you break down the global system, people are going to be more responsible for their own food production. And that means a lot less specialization and bringing wheat back to the core of the production system. In the United States, where we're a large geography, that's not a big issue. But everywhere else, the smaller the country in particular, the more of a problem that is. Because it used to be, and in globalization, you could export kumquats and import wheat, or export cars and import wheat. That's not going to be an option for most countries. And even before you consider things like the breakdown in the fertilizer supply chain, which we are already hip deep in because of the Ukraine war, simply matching production of each country to each country's needs is going to reduce the amount of calories the world grows by more than half. So in the best case scenario, where there are no wars over anything, we're already looking at having 3 billion more people than we can support, minimum.
I am hoping
with gains in technology that some of the countries that can keep producing a broad-based system, I think the US and France are going to be at the top of that list. Australia is probably on that list. Argentina, assuming they can get their head out of their ass, is on that list. That'll hopefully, along with a shift from large-scale animal protein to large-scale plant protein, reduce the number of people who die of famine over the course of the next 20 years to only a billion. That's still some horrific shifts, and I don't see any way to avoid it. Assuming for the moment you've got the food and the raw materials and the energy and the finance, which we've already eliminated 80% of the world's countries. Assuming you've got that, we're moving into a period where the younger generation is smaller than it's ever been. That would suggest that labor is actually going to have a leg up in those societies. We're certainly seeing that in the United States. It may not be the political democracy that we always have said we're after, but there is a degree of economic democracy that I think strengthens any sort of democratic system. So that is definitely happening here. We have seen greater wage appreciation in the last 2 years in the United States than we have in the last 20 for the lower tier economically, and I think that's great to a degree. It's also inflationary. That's another problem. In countries that don't, remember when I said we don't have an economic model for where we're moving? We don't have a political model for it either. Now, in the United States and in Mexico, where the change is happening most slowly, we're going to be able to tinker with the existing system for at least another 30 years. But in Europe and East Asia, where it's in collapse now, they're going to have to figure out a new way to do all of this. So hopefully those of us who are in North America can look to the Eastern Hemisphere and learn a few things, or even if it's just a few things that we shouldn't do, as opposed to might try. My biggest concern moving forward is that every time we've had a clash of economic models, especially when they've been in their infancy and just being developed, we have had conflicts. The Cold War, the German wars, at their heart, economic theory was there. It wasn't just geography. It wasn't just materials. It was about the role of the state. Well, we now get to do that on a global basis during an energy crisis and a food crisis and a financial crisis. We're not going to get it right on the first try. Usually in times of stress, the state tends to strengthen. And usually in times of war, the state tends to weaken because it needs to throw a wider net for support. So there are patterns in play that I'm, not exactly comfortable with. But when I look forward, that force countries to stop using oil and natural gas without having an alternative except for maybe coal, and then agricultural breakdowns, which are going to make at least half of the world's population food insecure. So these are not the sort of things that would normally generate a strong state. I think we're going to see dissolution in more places than we have. Well, we are definitely going to see state dissolution in more places than we have seen for the last 75 years. We've been living in the most charmed period in human history. For the countries that can make a go of it, it all depends upon how reliable their food and their energy supplies are and whether or not they can muster the internal finance to generate their own supply chains. That's easier with large polities than it is with small ones. So the United States, It's energy self-sufficient. It's a massive energy agricultural exporter. Its baby boomers are retiring, but as a percentage of their overall population, their baby boomer class is actually the smallest in the world. And so their financial crunch is going to be nearly as bad. They've got Mexico next door with a healthy demography. They've got Canada for raw materials, the Western Hemisphere for raw materials. The United States can grow through all of these problems. And even there, we are going to see the state gain additional power. In Europe, I mean, you're going to lose 4 to 5 million barrels a day of crude from the Russians within a couple of months. The only way you keep the lights on in Europe is to go and reinterface with the former colonies in Africa and force them to redirect their flows to Europe. To survive in the world that we are going to, Europe has to become neocolonial. How is that compatible with now what we understand as liberal multi-polar party democracy? We're going to find out. Remember, the entire economic model that the world is based on, whether it's fascism or communism or socialism or capitalism, it's all based on the concept that the pie is either stable or getting bigger, usually because of population growth. Well, now it's going to get smaller because of population collapse. At the same time, it's going to break into pieces. Everyone's going to have to find their own way to navigate that. And if democracy is something to be preserved, it goes into the mix in terms of a value statement that you can or cannot preserve. I'm far more worried about Central European and Southern European democracy than I am about Northern or Western, because Northern or Western has the capacity to go out and get some of what they need. They're going to be a little hypocritical about it when they do it, but the alternative for them is to deindustrialize. I am most interested in things that are in very large markets with deep pools of liquidity, which for the moment now is really just the United States. I want products that are energy intensive in their production, because in the United States, because of the shale revolution, we have the cheapest oil, the cheapest natural gas, the cheapest electricity. That's a huge competitive advantage, particularly as global supply chains break down. I look for things where their demand is demographically driven, because the United States has the healthiest demography in the rich world, and Mexico has the healthiest demography in the advanced and developing world. And if the product is exportable, great, because as supply chains globally break down, but North American ones get stronger, there's an arbitrage opportunity as well. And then, of course, because of the Ukraine war, I'm getting very, very big in the things that we need to make things that are no longer going to be flowing from the Russian system. So that's bauxite and aluminum. That's titanium, steel, pig iron, wheat, nitrogen-based fertilizers, phosphate-based fertilizers. If you can find any of that that is in the Western mold, or specifically in an American firm that is not exposed to the former Soviet Union, that's the catch there. They're good. The problem with all of this is that it doesn't match the investment theses that have been coming out in this capital-rich period where anyone can throw money at anything and it'll stick. So like if you want to invest in agriculture, for example, it's a global fund, and obviously it touches companies like Bungie that are very heavily invested into Ukraine and Russia, and they're losing everything. So you have to go more specific, and that's a lot more legwork. I would say overall, if you could only take one piece of advice away from this, the period of bottomless supplies of capital are ending, and that means capital is going to become harder to get. And that means we're probably going to have a lot fewer financial professionals, and they're going to have to prove that they offer a value add, because high frequency trading doesn't work. Broad index funds don't work. ETFs don't work in this environment. If there's less money available and there's more people who need it, the cost of that capital will rise. And if you are an investor, there's some wonderful opportunities here, but you have got to do your homework. You just can't rely on your CFA to go out and identify a half dozen funds, dump your money in, and then go and do something else. That doesn't work anymore.